Hey guys, Alex Moen here with another business book club update. So I just finished this book by Harvey MacKay. It's called Dig Your Well Before You're Thirsty. And I actually got into this book from the previous business book club episode one there by Jeffrey Gittimer. He mentioned this book in it, and I've very much been trying to get more into providing value, building the right connections kind of a thing. And so when he name dropped this particular book, I immediately went to Audible and downloaded it and put it in my line of books to cover there. So there were some little valuable bits here. Overall, it's really, I hate to say this, but there's nothing mind-blowing or out of the ordinary, right? But it's putting together all the right pieces, because it's really essentially a book about building relationships. So he uses the a 2 a.m. phone call example that I thought was the perfect example there. So he talks about a guy that he had been in touch with. I mean, they hadn't spoken in something like 10 years, and he got into a really tough financial spot and needed $20,000 right off the bat. And they were really close. Harvey MacKay is doing decently well. But he, when reflecting upon it, that 2 a.m. call, how many people do you have that would pick up your phone call at 2 a.m., much less give you money there? Now, Harvey MacKay, since they had kind of lost the relationship, he didn't give the full amount, but he did give him some money there, I guess, just as a little background note there. But who could you call in a tight spot at 2 a.m.? And I think many of us, myself included, it's probably not more than a couple or a few people, right? And so I thought that was an interesting way to look at it, to really be able to somewhat objectively measure your relationships. Now, some of the feedback on this book, it's been both great, and I see some negative things too. Some people seem to think that a book about networking or building relationships, it would be about using people. And that's actually, I didn't get that at all from the book. So you shouldn't be doing that. Of course, don't use or manipulate people there, right? But you should also focus on your relationships, be able to provide value to them. And that's really the biggest thing that I got out of it. Now, he has a few different ways to help build those relationships. Some of them, again, might even be cliched or you might have heard them before, but I think really putting them all together, having them top of mind, and coming with the idea that you're going to be networking and providing value is really a big thing. Because when people hear networking these days, I think people think of people just flashing out business cards and trying to sell you on something that you don't really need or whatever it might be. So those are the people that are thirsty, right? So they need something now, they're thirsty, and they're trying to get a well. But if you have the depth and you provide the value beforehand, you're going to have more resources at your disposal when you need them. So I think that's really the thing to think about here. And one thing that's been on my mind more and more, especially in the business world, is Harvey MacKay says you can't accomplish anything great alone. And I think that's something that's overlooked a lot. Like, you could be the best person ever, right? But you only have 24 hours in a day. If you want to be a great manager or you want to have great connections and build your business, you need to get other people on board. And you can't just get anyone on board, right? You can't manipulate them to do it, but you have to find the right people who are going to share your passion, share your goals there. And you have to provide them value first before they're probably even going to give you the time of the day, right? So there are a few key points that I'll kind of go through here that Harvey MacKay talks about. He uses an acronym RISK, R-I-S-K, and it stands for Reciprocity, Interdependence, Share, and Keep At It. So reciprocity, I've mentioned a couple times, it's providing value first, right? You can't go drink from the well if you haven't dug there yet. So if you're providing value to someone, it's just kind of in our nature as social animals that when two people meet, it's unknown what the other person is trying to get. They might think they're being used or manipulated, or they're just giving me the business card to sell me, or whatever it is. But if you kind of take that hit and you try and look from the perspective of providing value to other people without looking for anything in return, when it comes down to the line and you have that deep relationship and you need something, it's going to be far more likely to work out in your favor. And that leads into I, which is interdependence. So again, you can't do it all on your own. You can only do so much in a day. So provide value before you try and extract value, but also recognize that other people are better at you better than you at certain things. So you don't want to be your plumber and the architect of your house and the person who built your car or whatever it might be. So have a good interdependent relationship. There's something that you can do for other people that would be more advantageous for them to take advantage of, just higher ROI in terms of time, right? Or let's say if you knew nothing about plumbing and, you know, a big issue came up, you could just find a top high quality plumber and utilize them, save that money. You might think that you're paying too much up front by getting a plumber, right? Because maybe it's $100, $200 an hour even, but they can fix it right away versus you might have to go online or go to the library, read a book about it, troubleshoot, and then take days before something could be fixed by someone else there. So interdependence, just recognize when people are better than you there so you can boost yourself up, and you can hopefully boost them too when your particular skill set is needed. Share, that was a big thing there too. So that kind of goes back to providing value. And he has lots of little interesting things here too. So like writing personalized letters to them. That's something that now, especially in the electronic age, people don't really do so much anymore. So do you find an article or something specific to a person that shows that you kept them in mind? So maybe you're literally mailing them an article, or you can still email them an article if it's something that really fits into their interests or is something that works there. Maybe you're just sending off a note, whatever it might be. And then K, keep at it. It just takes time, right? You're not going to have a deep relationship overnight. You really have to keep at it and keep going, keep providing value and keep in touch. So there are just two more things I wanted to touch on about this book that I kind of pulled from it too. He has his 10 commandments there of networking. But I wanted to touch on a 2-minute drill. And so this I think is a little bit tougher to implement in real life, and I haven't done it just yet. But I think it's a good place to start potentially. So he would do this in big auditoriums and say, find someone that you've never met and you have 2 minutes to try and explain the depth of your soul more or less. So what's important to you in business and life, family, goals, whatever it is, you have 2 minutes to get all of that out there. And you take turns and do a 2-minute drill there. So I thought that was very interesting because lots of times, even the people that we spend lots of time around, we might never even really talk about our life goals or business goals or anything like that. It's something that's pretty rare in this day and age. And I think some people would be very open to talking about that, right? If it's something that means a lot to you, those are the things we tend to want to talk about and open up. And then if you can get someone else to do their 2-minute drill, and not just you going around spewing your 2-minute drill to people that wouldn't necessarily care, but if you're trying to find out about someone and learning how to provide value, you should really probably start with a 2-minute drill. So I haven't found out the best way to implement that just yet, but I think it's awesome and I wanted to note that so that I can even remember to follow up with it. So I know the 10 commandments here I'll go through pretty quickly. So number one, just don't assume the person with credentials is the one with the power. And this could come in a number of different forms. If you're trying to make a business connection, maybe it's the wife or the secretary or someone else that's whispering in their ear that has the actual power or helps influence them. Number two, don't confuse visibility with credibility. So just because you see someone, doesn't mean that they're the best for the job or that they're the best particular person in that field or that they'd be good for you to be a part of your network. Number three, I'm probably going to mispronounce this. It was a Yiddish word, if I remember correctly, but avoid being a schnorrer. And a schnorrer is, if I remember correctly, essentially an annoying person. So especially when networking, again, we all have the idea of the person just going around business cards, being very superficial, that kind of thing, or digging in. And really trying to extract value before providing anything. So avoid that. But number four, though, is never say no for the other person. So with this, what I kind of take with my sales background and things like that is let the other person say no. You can invite them to something or ask for a sale or whatever it is, but let them make their own decision. They'll say no if they want to. So keep that in mind. And number five, he mentions lots of time, bad grammar and all for this, but dance with the one who brung you. I believe that's from an older country song. So the idea, I think, behind the song was, you go to a party and with a girl or a guy, and you got to spend time with them. Don't go to that party and then try and dance with someone else. So similar thing here. He really focuses on how it's much better to have deeper relationships with people that you already know. If you're going to an event with a person, really stick with that person. But focus on that other relationship. So some things there when there are conflicting events, right? Maybe there's one thing going on with a new person who you think would be great to build a relationship with that conflicts with, someone that is already has an established relationship with you, but really default to the person that you already have that depth with, that person that is already proven themselves somewhat to you, and you've probably already have that relationship. I think too many people try and think of, okay, great, I've got this person, I've got them snagged, how can I get this other person and snag them? But what ends up happening is you degrade this relationship over here, and the new one that you snagged, it might not be as pretty as, well, once you kind of get to know it there, right? So kind of keep that in mind. Number six, this goes for people kind of working in other businesses, but don't assume that the company's network is the same as your own network. So once you have, leads, you've built relationships, don't wait until, you're going your separate ways to assume that that network's going to carry over to you with your new one. So just keep that in mind. If you end up getting fired, the company goes under. Do you lose all those leads? Do you lose all those relationships? So there's that. Number seven, don't stall, answer the call. So lots of people, myself included, unfortunately, sometimes when there's a call and there's something else going on, I end up procrastinating getting back to that or procrastinating getting back to the email. The thing here is just don't stall. When it's most convenient, when it's top of mind, just return it right away. Or better yet, answer the email on the spot, the text on the spot, the phone call on the spot if you can. If not, as soon as you can after. I think lots of people, again, myself included, unfortunately, sometimes are busy, but really we could, even in our busyness, fit in that person, that relationship, that time, and it would mean a lot to them there sometimes as well. Number eight, if you're unsure of something, ask your contacts. So I think that's really great too. Lots of times we try and answer questions on our own, but if you know somebody else knows the answer, I think that's a pretty good reason to give a quick phone call to your network or send off a quick email and ask a question. That other person's probably going to be flattered because you're deferring to their expertise and you're building a relationship at the same time as yourself getting the answer. You'll probably get the answer a lot more quickly there too. Number nine on his commandments is personal touch is my mantra. So again, people are one size fits all kind of things. I think in this day and age, we try and automate lots of different things and really have this generic message that goes out. And that just doesn't work as much anymore. So you need to be able to recognize the person as someone different and unique. Generic things just don't connect as well. So what's the personal touch? How is what you're trying to do or present to the other person, how's it meaningful to them? And then number 10, catch the zeitgeist and change with the zeitgeist. So that just means stay with the times. So this is actually a pretty old book, I believe in the 90s. I think Harvey MacKay was big even way before that. So all of this, it can apply to social media. It can apply to videos. It can apply to lots of different things. But you have to be on top of it, too. You don't want to be left in the dust for anything as well. So connect with people, but realize things are changing, environments are changing, and change with it. So again, one thing that he kind of ends on that I think is a good note to end on is your network is only as good as the information you can bring to it. Now, I think this is kind of good. It comes from a couple different angles, right? So if you have a question that you want answered or a problem or a business issue that comes up, how much can your network actually help you out there? If the answer is not much, then that says something about your network. But then also at the same time, you can think of it the other way. Your network is only as good as the information you can bring to it in terms of providing value. So what kind of value are you bringing to your network as well to help it grow? So let's end on that note. Your network is only as good as the information you can bring to it. I hope that was valuable. And let me know what you think. Have a good rest of your day, guys.